I am Hardlight of ReasonExperts.com. Welcome to this beginner's guide into Reason 10. In this particular case, I want to talk mainly about instruments. And over here, you have a section that's called instruments, effects, utilities, and players. I will just briefly touch this before I'm going to move on to the different instruments, so you kind of know like what's happening over here. For instance, if I stick in an instance of Thor, which is an instrument which I can play using the MIDI keyboard. Effects over here are usually effects for making adjustments within the sound itself. There are different ways that you can attach effects to an instrument. For instance, if I take something like a reverb, which makes things whole, I can decide to throw that under the instrument right here. An alternative route would be using that in combination with a insert effect chain, which is located over here inside of the mix channel. Show insert effect, throw it in there. It basically works the same way. The major difference between this setup and using that under the instrument itself is that eventually I could use the show programmer over here to make adjustments within the reverb, let's say the dry wet balance. And I could call this one the dry wet balance knob. And use this knob to control that knob right there. So that's something that is pretty handy to know. Then you have utilities. And utilities kind of do different things at the same time. The combinator over here is an easy tool to merge certain elements combined together. In this case, I'm going to stick in a Line 62 mixer, which allows you to attach six different instruments inside of one single combinator. An alternative route will be using the mixer 14.2, because in this case you can stack in more. But the nice thing about the mixer 14.2 to know is that you can also chain these indefinitely, because in this case the master chain is already like inserted inside of the first mixer channel, so you can have unlimited amount of channels inside of one single combinator. So for instance, if I want to layer a specific instrument, the combinator is most likely going to be the ideal choice. So in this case I have a Thor patch located over there, then I can stack in a let's go for an NNXT, load up a patch, let's go for a string that's under NNXT patches, strings right there, let's go for a tape string. So in this case I'm playing the Thor patch in combination with the tape string. The thing with utilities, they do something differently per utility. For instance, the RPG8 turns a normal instrument into an arpeggiated type of sequence. Also, what's also handy to know is that, for instance, audio tracks are also inside of the utility section, which allows you to, let's say, import audio tracks and manipulate that through the sequencer. Some may ask, like, why I'm having more Reason devices than the normal stock devices. That has something to do that these are so-called rack extensions, which you can buy from the shop. These are like plugins in case you need them. The last thing that is in here, that is players, and players is nothing more than an easy shortcut method to fiddle around, let's say, with skills and chords, where I can press one key to play a complete chord, as you can see right there. The same thing could be said for an arpeggiator. You can also chain these up, like you have the skills and chords first, and then it goes through the arpeggiator, press one note, and there goes that. From an instrument perspective, looking at the stock devices, you could kind of group these together. First of all, you have Kong, the drum designer, and you have the ReDrum drum computer. These two are ideal to build up complete drum tracks from the ground up. The difference over here is that the ReDrum drum computer allows only to load up samples. So if I go to, let's say, the Factory Sound Bank over here, there's a section that's called ReDrum Drum Computer. Then I have a section that's called Exclusive Drum Sorted. And if I click on Bass Drums, you will notice that all these files over here are all WAV files. So I can drag that on top of channel 1. And if I want to have a snare, I can go to Snare and then select over here snare drum right there, and then I can use the pattern subsequencer to program it over here, over here, over there, over there, like a traditional TR-808 did back in the days, just like that. Kong over here doesn't have the step sequencer enabled. It's more modeled after the 16 pads MPC type of thing, where you can load up basic patches. Could go for something clubby, throw that in there. And as you might already notice, is that these pads are velocity sensitive. Since this is a beginner's guide, I'm not going to go that much in depth about how to program a Kong device. The only thing that you need to know, if you're going to touch that realm, there's a panel over here that's called Show Drum and Effects. If I open that, then I'm getting like the under the hood type of thing. So if I trigger pad 1, it will display a different thing than if I trigger pad 2. Because I'm looking under the hood like what's inside of that box more or less. That's from a beginner's point of view what you need to know. Then we have the synth sections. And the synths come with Europa, then you have Thor, then you have the Subtractor, and then you have the Maelstrom Grain Table Synthesizer. There's a huge difference between these four. Because, for instance, Europa is modeled after a wavetable synthesizer that you have one waveform, and if I use the shape knob over here, I can go through that waveform. If I stick that against, let's say, an LFO, low frequency oscillator, I'm going to set an amount that I can make automatic changes within that waveform itself. And if I'm going to apply, let's say, a different waveform, wavetable transformer, for instance, and reset this LFO a little bit slower, there. It's like a moving wavetable. That's what basically what Europa does. But it can go really deep with this synth. But that's with any synthesizer in particular. Then you have Thor. And Thor is quite unique what it does. Because the benefit behind Thor is that most of the power lies within the show programmer part. If I click that, I get another under the hood type of feel. And in this case, I can set different oscillator types. This is the wavetable oscillator. This is the phase modulation oscillator. That is the vampire. I'll deal to create those FM type of piano type of things. And then you have a multi oscillator, which is good for creating trance tunes. Stuff like that. The Subtractor is quite like an old synthesizer. It's very simplistic. And if you're going to learn synthesis in particular, this will be one of those synths to look at, like what it really does, as in terms like what an amplitude is and what modulation does and stuff like those. Because understanding this synth is the most easiest one to make that work. This is one of the first synths that I picked up to learn my ways into synthesis, in particular inside of Reason itself. Just because of the fact that everything is already laid out inside of the screen, and you basically twist a few knobs, and then you get a feel like what's really happening with the synthesizer in particular. It's really easy to understand like what this concept does. So from a synthesizer perspective, I would pick up the Subtractor if you're really new to these type of things. Fill around with a few knobs and see what it does. The Maelstrom, on the other hand, is a really odd beast. Because this is kind of like a thing that is based on gray table synthesizers. And the way that you can see it is that you have multiple waveforms that are being chopped up into multiple sections. And those are called grains. And what you will do is play them back inside of a sequence. To present this the best way is using a thing that's called the VS Waves. Because the VS Wave is something that uses 64 different waveforms. If I set the motion all the way to zero, and I play it like this, and I would change the index, I get a different waveform. But if I take the motion halfway there, And I would play it like this. I'm playing all those waveforms in a sequence. As you can hear right there. From a beginner's perspective, this synth in particular may be a little bit like hard to understand like what it's really doing, because you have no visual presentation like what it's doing. But just understand the concept that you have multiple waveforms and these are chopped up into grains. Next to that, you also have a thing that's called the Dr. Octorex. The Dr. Octorex is nothing more than you have a loop, and that loop is chopped up into multiple sections, slices, and that results into a loop player. There are plenty of loops out there inside of the factory soundbag. I can say copy loop to the track, and I can enable playback, disable the playback mode over there, and then you can see visually that these are all the slices. And it plays that whole thing in a sequence. As you can hear right there. If you are up to it, you can also make your own custom made Rex loops if you want to. This is done like this. You basically add an additional audio track. The thing that I could do next is say import an audio file. In this particular case, I will go for an amen break. Sounding like that. I will crank up the tempo on 170 beats per minute, and I will press and hold the control key while taking this arrow, which is equal to time stretching right there. So there's that. Then I can go back to the song mode, pressing control E. Next thing that I'll need is to double click it over here, so it actually analyzes the audio snippet and translates the transients to slices. Then I can say right click and then say bounce clip to Rex loop. When I'm doing that, I can use this Rex loop to attach to any Rex player that I have. So for instance, if I go to Octorex loop player right there, I can open up the panel over there and I can drag in this wave file over there and say copy loop to track and disable the playback mode. So in this case, I have the exact same loop. Now as a Rex loop. That's the Dr. Octorex in a nutshell. Then we have a wide range of different samplers. The first one will be the NNXT. The second one will be the NN19. And the special one would be the Grain Sample Manipulator. Because this is an introduction video, I will not go that much in depth about this whole thing. The only thing that I'm going to mention over here is that the NNXT is ideal if you have like complex layered sounds that you need to manually layer differently from one to another. For instance, if I select over here the thing that's called combos and echoes over here, there I can see all the different layers that sit inside of the NNXT. So it's ideal if you have multiple sound layers that need to be layered together as a sample library, if you will. The NN19, however, is the more simplistic version of being a sample player, because the only thing that you do is load up a sample. Even better yet, you could even use this thing as a drum computer if you want. That's that. I'm using a re-drum sample. Loading that up inside of an NN19 sampler. So this thing is pretty easy to use to, let's say, throw in a sample and make use of that sample inside of a sequencer like this. And the only thing that you need to understand from this principle is that C3 over here is usually, most commonly, the native node of the playback of the sample. Yep. As you can hear it there. If I'm going to go for a higher octave setting over here, it will also turn this thing into a pitched up sample. As you can hear it there. Make note, the NN90 nor the NNXT apply time stretching, because that's something that's handled through audio tracks. Range, on the other hand, is something special, because what I will do is play back a sample in a granular type of way, where you have different options over here.
I want to have my
to play back a sound to play back a sound into all kinds of different ways.
I want to have my to have my to have my to have my voices, 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 here we go.
As you can see right there. What you could do is create really short loop points, but use this section to manipulate that in all kinds of different ways. This is ideal for creating creative effects using your own voice even. Or you could take an existing sample that's already there and throw it inside of Grange to turn that into something new. So if you opt for the challenge, I would just do that. Experiment with it and see what kind of things you can create from it. So if you're up for the challenge, just create something creative with Grange. Yeah, there's that. A few mentions over here, the ID8 plugin. This is often the replacement tool for importing MIDI files, because it contains most of the sounds that sit inside of general MIDI. An alternative route would be using the NNXT instead. Then you have Radical Piano, which is like a piano. These are all sample-based libraries, by the way, in case you're wondering. Additionally, you have stuff like Clang, Pangea, and Humana, which are samples, instruments that you can use to play certain sounds, for instance, voices. Or you could go for something like a belly type of thing. Stuff like that. Last instrument, that is a special one. That's located over here. That's the external MIDI. This thing by its default state does not create any sound at all, because this device in particular is being used to either control an external MIDI device or do it the exact opposite way, that you have an external device that controls this device in particular and then can use that to control a different device that sits inside the region itself. But this is more the advanced stuff, and if you are really up for the challenge, use that. If you have like an external MIDI keyboard. Personally, I use the Launchpad in this particular context a lot. I have also done some videos about those. Anyways, this was a little bit like an introduction video towards the instruments that sit inside a region. Also talking you through the basic folder over here where you have instruments, effects, and utilities, and players. Have lots of fun. And I will talk to you later.